Part of the world of bacteria includes something called an F plasmid. The F plasmid is a small circular piece of DNA. The F plasmid has an origin of replication, so that when the bacteria replicates, the F plasmid replicates. It's kind of like the most primitive and simplest virus there is. It's a parasite on the bacteria. Molecular biologists have taken the idea of the F plasmid and expanded it into a very powerful tool for molecular biologists. The bacterial artificial chromosome is something that the molecular biologist buys over the internet with a credit card. Maybe delivery's free, I don't know. But the big picture is to take the bacterial artificial chromosome and insert the DNA of interest into this vector. And then the vector placed in the bacteria will automatically replicate and automatically be stable and preserved. Basically, it's a tool for molecular biologists. Let's take a look at the bacterial artificial chromosome. The bacterial artificial chromosome has an origin of replication, the same as the F plasmid. Important is that it has a gene for ampicillin resistance. It's a trick. In fact, it's all tricks in a way. But it has a gene for ampicillin resistance. And importantly is that it has a place called the multiple cloning site. The multiple cloning site is a recognition site for pretty much every restriction endonuclease you could ever want. This is a tool that's been manufactured, and the people that make these have put restriction sites in for about every restriction enzyme you could ever imagine. Let's take a look at it a little bit more specifically. The multiple cloning site includes a site for a BAMH1 recognition site. The site is right here. And it includes a site for ZO1 recognition. That's right here. So that when the bacterial artificial chromosome, when this vector is subjected to BAMH1 and ZO1, two things happen. First of all, it is linearized. It's no longer circular. And the second thing is that it leaves these two sticky ends. And notice that the two sticky ends are not compatible with each other. So the molecular biologist buys the bacterial artificial chromosome, applies restriction enzymes to it, giving it sticky ends. The trick now is to take the DNA of interest, give it compatible sticky ends, and mix them together and ligase the insert into the original bacterial artificial chromosome, into the same vector. Let's say, for example, we want to add the piece of DNA that goes from here and then through, and it comes out to here. This is the piece of DNA we're interested in, from here to here. And this could have come from the NCBI website. It could have come from just about anywhere. Could have been something that was purchased. So all of this DNA we want added up to here, all of this gets added. The trick to putting the sticky ends, it kind of comes along with the polymerase chain reaction. So we want to do polymerase chain reaction on this piece of DNA. We need a primer. The forward primer, we want the forward primer to match with 20 bases here. 20 bases is 4 to the 20th specificity, which is plenty of specificity. The primer, the working side of the primer is the 3' end. Recall that the 5' on the free trinucleotide goes on the 3' of the growing DNA strand. So the TAC polymerase looks at the 3' end. The 5' end there's a little bit of latitude on the 5' end. So we have our 20 bases that gives us our specificity, and on the 5' end, we add a restriction site for ZO1 and restriction endonuclease. So we have the 5', and then we have a ZO1 site on the end of it. And then on the other side, we have, same thing, we want 20 bases that are specific. 20 bases that are specific. And then on this side, we want a BAM H1 restriction site. So that we've got the specificity plus the BAM H1 restriction site. And then the reverse primer, we need the reverse complement of what we're looking at here. So we have our pair of primers figured out. We send our order to an oligonucleotide synthesis company and they make the primers for us. So with the primers come in the mail and we do polymerase chain reaction on our suspect DNA using our pair of primers and we get a set of amplicons. The primers are part of the amplicons. The amplicons, the ends of the amplicons are the primers. So we've got our DNA of interest with a restriction site on one end and a restriction site on the other end. We take our amplicons, purify it, apply our two restriction enzymes to it, and the sites now become sticky ends. We take our insert with sticky ends. We take our bacterial artificial chromosome with sticky ends. We put them together in the same room at about 37 degrees centigrade. Let them incubate together for a short time. The two sticky ends will find each other and hybridize to each other, but we need to add ligase to fix the phosphodiester bonds to actually make it into a circular piece of DNA again. This has been a series of tricks. There are two more. The next trick is, how do we get our piece of circular DNA back into the bacteria? The bacteria's job is to keep stuff out. So how do we get it back in to the inside of the bacteria so it'll behave the way we want it to? It's called transformation. And there's a couple of tricks, quite a few techniques. One of them is thermal shock. One of them is using like a gel electrophoresis, like a gel field, maybe shaking it. Maybe something with osmotic pressure, but somehow we've got to get our circular DNA back into the bacteria. And then the last trick is, you look at this and think, this is all kind of dodgy. I mean, is this really going to work? When you're done, you have a billion cells approximately with a billion possible inserts. Some of these cells are going to work. So what you do is you take the culture that you have, you concentrate it as much as you can, and you plate it out on an auger dish that has ampicillin. And the inserts that worked and are properly put into the bacteria will grow and nothing else will. Out of a billion cells, if you've done your job properly, some of them are going to grow and you're going to get some colonies. You don't really need more than one. So what makes this tool so powerful? One aspect of this is that the bacterial artificial chromosome will take enormous inserts. You can put 100 to 200,000 bases into a bacterial artificial chromosome. The chromosome is circular. There's no telomeres to worry about. The bacteria has a very simple metabolism. There's no fancy stuff going on in the bacteria. Yeast is a much more complicated organism to deal with. Yeast, of course, being eukaryotic and having a nucleus and a nuclear membrane. Bacteria doesn't have any of that. There's no complications really. The clone that you've just made is extremely stable. It's carried in the bacteria. Culture up the bacteria and put it in a freezer, and it will be stable for months to decades to maybe like indefinitely. I don't know, but it's very stable. It's predictable in its behavior. It'll take very large inserts. The Human Genome Project used bacterial artificial chromosomes extensively. In the Human Genome Project, the shotgun approach takes the human genome, breaks it up into large overlapping sections, clones them into bacterial artificial chromosomes, and then sends them around the world for duplication, for to be sequenced. When the sequences come back, and then they're all pumped into a computer, and the computer munches and crunches on them and comes up with the human genome. The idea of recombinant DNA, the idea of clones, this is it.